then you want to be born with the Day's Amendment on 1st day of September. Today we have amongst us Dr. Narendra Jadhav, Principal Advisor, Department of Economic Analysis and Policy, Reserve Bank of India. Mr. M.N. Chenny, President MEDC, Mumbai and Member Governing Council of India Group of Institutes, Pune. And our own Mrs. Taika Wakankar-Mahendra, Chairperson, India Group of Institutes, Mr. Chetan Wakankar, Group Director, India Group of Institutes, Mrs. Prachi Javadekar, Director, India Institute of Management, Ms. Madhuri Sade, Director, Corporate Relations, Mr. Divakar, Director, GEB, Dr. Dilip Sarwate, Senior Consultant and Executive Director, GEB. Now may I request you all, ladies and gentlemen, to kindly stand in the honor of the National Anthem. Ma'am, we don't have to go far for a role model for this program. We believe at India that successful entrepreneurs are not born but can be trained. So we have adopted a two-pronged approach in training successful entrepreneurs. The first is regular classroom training, which Dr. Sarvade has already used the core faculty for that. It's already launched last Monday. And it is supplemented by experience sharing and invited lectures by eminent personalities as well as successful entrepreneurs. It is in this context, Dr. Jadhav sir, that we look forward to your words of wisdom and experience sharing. Once again, I welcome you all to this program.
Thank you, Mr. Devakar. May I now invite Mr. M. N. Jain to speak a few words about our distinguished guest for the day and introduce him to the panel.
Good morning, everybody. Well, friends, on your behalf, also on behalf of Indira Group and Maharashtra Economic Development Council, it's my pleasure to welcome Dr. Narendra Jadhav, an outstanding economist, a person of rare talent, an author of his own right, and may I say, shall I describe in one nutshell, as a man, zero to hero. The person who started really from nowhere, and today he is the principal advisor to RBI, the apex body to the government of India. It's a rare achievement, and Dr. Jadhav has done in his own style in almost difficult to describe how well and how able he is actually. I have a very long biography of almost 10 pages, and I'm not going to read all that. But I'm going to certainly suggest in their group that perhaps this biography should be printed in their magazine, because it's such a wonderful biography and good for the students, especially the students who are looking to the role models. Now, we have been bringing role models. We brought Dr. Kurian, the person who revolutionized the Indian economy, who brought quite revolution and took India, or made India the largest milk producer in the world. So that was about the economy. The whole food, milk is the whole food. Then we had another speaker who was on the housing, and now we got the speaker who is on the money. So friends, you got almost everything now. You got food, you got a house, and now you get something about the money so that you will know how to enjoy it. When I talk of Dr. Narendra Jadhav, I'm sure most of you met him in Sanskrit. He himself is a Sanskrit scholar. I would definitely recommend you to read a book written by him. It is in Marathi, which is called Amcha Bap An Ami. It has been translated into English and in French also. So those who can't read English and Marathi, I recommend you to read French as well. But I certainly read Marathi, and believe me, I read it twice. First I read it because it was interesting. But then, some of the things that he and his father have gone through, or his family and his father have gone through, I couldn't believe it. And therefore, I really sort of, you know, once again went through the critical aspects of Jadhav family, their travel from a tribal place, a place unknown, to what they are. In fact, talking to Dr. Narendra Jadhav, I'm tempted to use that Sanskrit couplet. Karagre vasate lakshmi, karamadhe saraswati. I'm sure you people know enough Sanskrit. And I'm not as good a scholar as Dr. Dadav on Sanskrit, though Sanskrit is my favorite language. But what it means is, you got Lakshmi, goddess of wealth, on your fingertips, and you got knowledge, or goddess of education, goddess of knowledge, in your hand, in your palm. Now Dr. Dadav has got both of them. He's the RBI advisor, so he's talking on money. And what he has achieved is totally because of the education. It's totally because of the education. And that's why that I feel that Karagre Vasate Lakshmi Karamadhe Saraswati fits in quite well. While I'm going to introduce Dr. Narendra Dadav, I think you'll pardon me, his description according to me is not complete without reference to his father, late Damodar Dadav, who really has given them the values or the principles or the virtues. He literally transmitted them into his children. He was a man of few words. I think he almost, he didn't really have formal education in that sense. But somehow he spoke good English, and he told his children, "I speak better English than you because I learned from the British directly. You guys are learning from the nations." But see, this gentleman who had almost no education, but he practiced the principles which even the educated, the so-called rich, the so-called high society people don't. He told his children, education is the key to your success. So education, study. Don't worry about my problems. Don't worry about the problems of the family. But study. You are good in school. You study well. You will do well. And the other thing he told about the integrity. You may recollect, Dr. Kurian also said, when you asked something about him, he said, only I can answer whatever question you are asking to that. The only solution to India's problem is integrity. And Dr. Dadav's father told exactly the same thing, the man of few words, man who worked as a junior staff in railways, he talked of only integrity. In fact, if Dr. Dadav permits me, and I think he would permit, because he has published in the book also, he traveled without ticket in the train, and his father caught him, and he punished him very well, which he still remembers. So that is the speciality of his father, which he transmitted to his children, and therefore all the sons of Mr. Dadav could achieve rare positions. His eldest brother, Janardhan Dadav, an IS officer, the first IS officer in his community, and rose to the level of secretary to government of Maharashtra as well as municipal commissioner to Mumbai. The second brother also became deputy municipal commissioner to Mumbai. And Dr. Narendra Dadav is only half the way of his journey. He's only 50 and still a lot too. And at this stage, he is at this level, and I'm sure whatever my interactions with him have been, with that, he will go far further. Maybe tomorrow he may become a member of parliament of Rajya Sabha or Lok Sabha. Maybe he may become minister. And we would really need people like him at the helm of the affairs so that the Indian economy, Indian polity, India in general can do better. Well, I can talk a lot about all this, but I think if I do that, perhaps I'll cover his speech, which I don't want to. We have a lot to know from him, learn from him, and as I said, he's an outstanding orator too. I'll just highlight some of his academic background. He's a BSc graduate from Bombay in 1973. Postgraduate from Bombay in economics with mathematical economics and econometrics, and then doctorate in PhD, from Indiana University, again in economics with international economics and econometrics. One of the things I should tell you, when he got his PhD, mind you, it was a very tough thing to do, because his guide, the person who was conducting his PhD thesis, was not so friendly with him. At some stage, Dr. Jadhav, although on principle they were together, on certain issues they were not together. And you know, if you got a bad teacher, how difficult it is to get the marks. And even with that kind of background, Dr. Jadhav got 3.93 rating for the grade out of 4. And not only that, it is the highest, and he has established an academic record in Indiana University. That record is. Well, his professional experience, I would just read it quickly because I think it is relevant, that is why. As it is said, since 2002, he is officer in charge, Department of Economic Analysis and Policy, Reserve Bank of India. November 2001 to March 2002, he served as advisor to Montek Singh Ahluwalia, Director, Independent Evaluation Office, International Monetary Fund. Then, again, he was advisor to the Executive Director, India, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh and Bhutan at the International Monetary Fund. He was also an advisor to the Executive Director, to the Executive Board of IMF, which is still in session. Then, in 1996, he served as an officer in charge, Department of Economic Analysis and Policy, again Reserve Bank of India. He is holding several key positions in RBI, and therefore he has a tremendous knowledge of wealth of experience related to the monetary policy, related to the credit policy, and all the economic aspects of Indian economy. In fact, today I believe, I really did not discuss what exactly he is going to talk to you. He has his own, but I would also suggest, because of his background, his exposure, his experience with all industry as well as the banking sector and international exposure, he should cover what today's Indian banking system and RBI policy, how it relates to the Indian industry, because you are all young students, you aspire to be businessmen. So from that point of view, if he covers the issues, so that you will be able to narrate that, relate that, and that will be useful to you. He has tremendous international exposure, as I just said. He was in IMF, World Bank. He has visited Japan, Hong Kong as a high-powered capital market delegation led by D.R. Mehta, the then chairman of SEBI. He has participated in almost all conferences in Asia and workshop on special data transmission, etc. If I go through all that, I think it's too much. I would rather cut short on that. He also has several scholastic honors, which I should mention specifically. He's a national scholar in economics. He's the best international student. He got the best international student award in 1983. He also has got an award for outstanding contribution to the economic theory for the PhD, which I just described. And this is something outside his routine of the economy, is that he has also got Maharashtra Sahitya Parishad Award. That he is a writer, he is an author of his own right, that is. He also got award, C.D. Deshmukh Award from Maharashtra Chamber of Commerce and Industry, and he got a national award, a Five Foundation National Award, for his contribution to the Indian culture. So friends, we have today a chief guest who has such a diverse exposure. He is a author, a literature person, he is an economist, he has a very fine taste of culture, he has an international exposure, he is a banking expert. And he also understands, being young, and he interacts with the youth, and therefore he understands the aspirations of the youth. He knows what are the problems of India today, of the youth, of the employment, almost all the aspects. And therefore, I think his speech today is going to be very useful, very guiding, or I would say almost like a coming from a mentor. He could be a mentor of several of you. That kind of a status he enjoys. And therefore, I'm really very happy that Dr. Gaurav could accept our invitation to be here today and share his thoughts, his ideas on economy and on industry and the future of the youth. So therefore, Dr. Gaurav, thank you very much for being here. And with that, although I could really would not do the justice to entire your biography or CV that you have here, but I think since it will be in the digest, that will be more useful, and I will give more time for you to share your thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cheney. Very generous introduction. Actually, the copy of the biodata that I have given him is a shorter one. I have a longer one. And you'll be grateful to me for not giving him the longer biodata because he was so generous in introducing myself. What he did not tell you all, though, is that all these years, I have been a great admirer of Mr. Cheney himself. And as you all know, he has been a role model for many, and I feel very happy and fortunate to have known him and seen him from close quarters for such a long time. And it is basically because of him that I'm here today. So let me start the formal address. Shri Cheney, Srimati Mehendre, Srimati Prachi Davdekar, Sri Kakalkar, Mr. Divakaran, Professor Saravane, Saravane, Shirupai, faculty members of this great institute, group of institutes, I must say, and my young friends. It's indeed a great pleasure as well as an honor to be here. I'm truly delighted for two reasons. I always enjoy coming to Pune because, as I was telling Professor Bhaga on the way, Pune is a great place to go and debate because everybody in Pune has opinion on every subject. Pune has been known for that for long. Everybody outside Pune holds this grudge against the people of Pune. And therefore, it's a great thing to come to Pune and talk. And secondly, I met Prachi Javadekar in New York a couple of months back, and I came to know more about Indira Group of Institutes, and I was very impressed by what I heard, and I was looking forward to an opportunity, and that was when MEDC, Mr. Cheney and his colleagues approached me, and I thought that was a good opportunity to come here and talk to you. So this is a great occasion for me to come and share a few thoughts with you. And I realize that I'm in a very distinguished company here, following the two great speakers who have come here. So I feel elated, grateful for having chosen me to come here and talk to you. Now, we had some discussion about what am I supposed to discuss with you. And Mr. Cheney also made a few points. Now, what I propose to do is to speak to you for 45 minutes on the kind of change that is taking place in the environment. And when I talk about environment, I talk about the macroeconomic environment. RBI, of course, is a part of it. As the central bank of the country, it would be a part of it. But as Mr. Cheney suggested, the kind of change that is taking place and what is the kind of world out there that you are going to face after you finish your education. I want to tell you about the change that is taking place and the kind of change that is needed in your mindset to go and grapple with the problems that you are going to have, to exploit the opportunities which will come your way, and to face the challenges that you are bound to emerge as you go in the world out there. So I'm going to talk about that kind of broad change, and within the context of the broad change, we will talk about the Reserve Bank and its role in different fields, and what kind of things are happening today. So that is what I intend to talk, and I've been told that this is an interactive session, so please feel free to, interaction doesn't have to depend until my monologue is over. Even while I'm speaking, if there is something that you do not understand or you want to question, feel free to start asking questions. Ideally, let me finish my 45-minute presentation, so to say, and then we can take questions. Not that I have answers to all the questions, but I certainly can take a shot. Change. And we're going to talk about the change. Mahatma Gandhi, many years back, said that only thing constant in this world is change. And how prophetic that has been is the first thing that I think you should recognize. The only constant thing in life is change. Now, the pace of change changes. You know, those of you who are studying mathematics will know the second order derivative. There is a change, but there is a change in the rate of change. And what has happened is that the pace of change has accelerated. If you look at the last century, I want to emphasize that the change that took place in the environment in which we all operate, the change that took place in the last 10 years was more than the change that took place in the 90 years before that. So if you look at the last 100 years as a period of change, the last 10 years of last decade of that century alone, the pace of change was so rapid that the amount of change achieved in the last 10 years was more than the change that was achieved in the first 90 years. And that pace is going to accelerate further. And therefore, change and the enhanced, accelerated pace of change is something that we all have to understand and grapple with. Now, what are the kind of changes? Why is there so much change in the recent past, in the last 10 years, and why does it continue in the new millennium? Basically, it was triggered in the last 10-12 years, it was triggered by three things. Revolutionary advances in computers, telecommunications, and informatics. That has been the driving force. The driving force of change that you see is because of metamorphic changes, revolutionary advances in computers, electronics combined, telecommunications, and informatics. One distinct change that we see is that there is now a death of distance. You know, there is a death of distance. This is a very interesting phenomenon that everybody is talking about. That distance really does not matter. Something which was unthinkable earlier is happening now. You have seen the examples from medical subscription to a whole range of things which are during the daytime in America, they work and they pass it on while we are working here in the daytime, and the next day when they go back, it's all there, whatever processing is to be done. And I don't know whether you have noticed it, but now the statistics is also out. If you look at 1,000, this Fortune, earlier they used to have Fortune 500, now they are Fortune 1,000 company. One out of every four company has outsourced from India, and that number is going to go up. So what has happened is this is a change that is taking place all over and is also getting into Indian economy. And we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about this kind of change with the death of distance and the revolutionary advances. These are bringing out a complete metamorphosis, a complete transformation of the world. You will recall that some of you, Chandi Saab was talking about Sanskrit. You know, in our old books, there is a talk about Vasudheva Kutumbakam, which is the whole earth is one. It's the family. That exactly is actually happening. We have been talking about it, but that's happening now. That is happening now in the sense that the world is coming together at a mind-boggling pace and is getting integrated. And that is creating many opportunities, and it is also throwing up many challenges, and we need to understand those. When did the process of change started in India? Curiously, the change in India started exactly when the pace was accelerating all over the world, in 1991. In 1991, some of you at least would be aware, we had an unprecedented macroeconomic crisis. The foreign exchange reserves of the Reserve Bank of India had dwindled to a level of only $1 billion. Now, how do you judge? Chenjisa was talking about money and Lakshmi and the Reserve Bank. Reserve Bank is called Reserve Bank because of the reserves of the banks that it has. It is also called Reserve Bank because it also manages the foreign exchange reserves of the country. Now, how do you judge whether foreign exchange reserves of a country are too much, too little, or just right? Earlier, the standard rule of thumb, which has now changed, because the rule of thumb is also changed. Earlier, they used to say that, why do we need foreign exchange? We need foreign exchange essentially to pay for our imports. Therefore, adequacy of foreign exchange reserves should be judged in terms of how many months of imports it can finance. Like your inventory management. You have to have inventory of sorts. You should have foreign exchange reserves which will finance your 4 months of import, was the standard rule at that time. We did have that kind of situation for long. But during the decade of 80s, the way we became profligate on the fiscal side, our fiscal deficit was going like crazy, going up like crazy. We were profligate, and foreign exchange reserves were dwindling. And as a result of our foreign exchange reserves dwindling, in 1991, we had a situation where our foreign exchange reserves were only $1 billion, which was equivalent of only 2 weeks of our imports. 2 weeks of our imports was the situation. So we were on the brink of a default. That was for the first time that people on the street came to realize that India is having a major crisis. And that was the turning point. That was the turning point, and some of you will still remember, and you will hear your father or uncle or your grandfather cribbing about the great thing or the sad thing that we did in terms of pledging our gold and keep sending it abroad. I still remember those days. It was May 1991 and 47 tons of gold had to be sent abroad for getting money. The reason was we were on the brink of default. And you know, in the international financial arena, there is no room, there is no room for error, there is no margin for error. You build your credibility by years of experience, prompt payment and all that. And one default, all the credibility that you have earned can go down the drain on that day. And we were afraid of that, and we were very close to that. We had foreign exchange reserves for only 15 days worth. And nobody was prepared to give us money. Nobody was prepared to lend any money to India. Indian economy was like a patient in intensive care unit for which people were saying that it's a question of time when he is in such a, in the last stage, marginal. And we had done, nobody did that to us. We had done that to ourselves, and I'll come to that. And that was a situation where we started, we had to. That was also politically a very dicey situation. There was virtually no government. The government was going down. Chandrasekhar was the prime minister, and there was political crisis brewing, and there was no effective government. And that is why RBI had to step up and take measures which were very unconventional. And one of the most unconventional one was this gold. Since there is a lot of confusion about that, and you will keep hearing about that from other sources, let me clarify, because there is so much misconception about that. How much gold did we send? 47 tons. I still remember when the truck carrying the gold, we had kept the whole thing hush-hush because nobody likes family gold to be shipped. But there was no option because nobody was giving us money and we needed fish finance. And the truck taking the gold got stuck in traffic jam near Mahalakshmi temple. And a lot of us, especially the governor and deputy governors, almost had a heart attack when somebody pointed out that we have forgotten to insure the gold. By the way, the reporter who published the story about the gold being shipped out was given the national award that for that year for investigative journalism. Lot of criticism was there of RBI as to why we should take people into confidence. You can't, because when there is an emergency, there is an emergency. You have no time to take people into confidence. And we had to do something very unconventional, we did. But it was blown out of proportion. You see, that typically the newspaper response was that, look, now our country is finished. Now you are selling your family gold. You know, you are selling your gold abroad. Where, what has happened to our honor? It's all gone. You know, this country has now completely gone to naught. That doesn't help. You have to fight and put the country back where it belongs. And how much was the gold that we're sending? 47 tons. How much gold do we have? Reserve Bank has 365 tons of gold, give and take one or two tons. Private hands. We have one of the largest gold holding in the private hands, something like 15,000 tons. Now as compared to that, 47 tons was actually ki jhaati patti and all that. But newspapers will never give you that perspective. It was 47 tons and 15,000. And you know the great passion that women have about gold. So we have accumulated a lot of gold. If you look at the value of gold that we have, it's each ton of gold is $11.2 million. So you convert that $11.2 million, 15,000 tons, and 15,000 is a rough and ready estimate. Nobody knows what is the actual holding of gold in India. The total amount is huge, but all this amount is kept in lock and key. And it's not being used for the country. In a way, it's a dead investment. As an investment also, it is very bad, the recent times have shown. But the point was, at that time, we did something unconventional. We shipped this gold, we wanted bridge finance, we got that. Then the new government came to power. Manmohan Singh took over July 1991, and then a new era began. Incidentally, the people who were complaining, I was given the job of facing the newspapers at that time. You know, when there is a crisis, I'm the troubleshooter for the Reserve Bank of India. So they made me the PRO at that time, and I was facing the newspapers. And I used to have debates about what they were craving and writing critical stories about gold going abroad. You know, I want to bring it to your notice. The argument was that people must know. You have to take people into confidence. I want to bring out now. You know, the gold was sent out. In 6 months, within 6 months, we got our gold back. When the gold went out, it was an 8-column headline on the front page. When the gold came back, it was on the 5th page, 7th column at the bottom. So this is the mindset. This is very important. You have to learn to read between the lines. If people felt so bad for sending the gold out, you should have seen people dancing on the street when the gold came back. You did not see that. Why? Because the news came on the 7th page, 5th column at the bottom. That is, I think it's very important lesson there, that you have to read between the lines and you have to understand the kind of emergency that we have and the kind of solutions that we need. But on a more positive note, it was a turning point for India's economic policy. And we started so-called new economic policy. What we call new economic policy may be new for us, but it is not new for the world. You know, it was there. China started with that in 1978. East Asia started it, in fact, before China, in early 70s. We call it, and there are still a lot of people debating. And I tell you, there are lots in Pune who debate about that, about this and about that, and how we must leave IMF, and how must kick out the WTO, and how must we must come out of the World Bank. This goes on, but I want you to understand the kind of changes that are taking place, and where do we want to go? We don't want to go towards anarchy. We want to work within the system and get the best deal for our country. That's our objective. That's our basis. That is our premise. What happened was, in 1991, when we started the new economic policy, there were two sets of things which were done. One is called, and this you will read in the paper and in the books, macroeconomic stabilization and structural adjustment. Macroeconomic stabilization and structural adjustment, right? Let me explain to you in totally non-technical words what are, because these are the words which are being thrown at you all the time. The example that I gave, especially to students, is very simple. If a house is on fire, the first responsibility is to put out the fire. When the economy is on fire, the first responsibility is to stabilize that, put out the fire. The economic measures, policy initiatives which are taken to do that are called macroeconomic stabilization. It involves a lot of things. Then the second one, more important, is structural adjustment. When the house is on fire and you put out the fire, your next responsibility is to reconstruct. After putting out the fire, it doesn't stop. Your job is to recreate a new structure. Two kind of economic measures of the kind which are done for the economy, if you say, take the same analogy to economy, the kind of measures which are taken for that are the structural adjustment measures. The structural adjustment measures, let's talk about that, because those are really taking place now. Structural adjustment measures that we are talking about can be divided into three categories. One is liberalization, second is privatization, and third is globalization. I was surprised to find that some people abbreviate that as LPG, liberalization, privatization, and globalization. And I tell you, for me, LPG was liquefied petroleum gas. This one is no less explosive than LPG that they are talking about. Now, they have made it explosive. Let's understand, because these three are changing the face, the economy of our country, and are going to do that in the near future. This process is continuing. Let's talk about liberalization. What is meant by liberalization? What is the change that is unleashed because of liberalization? What had happened in India was that for a variety of reasons, we don't want to go into ancient history or give a discourse on long-term development of how this came to. But basically, by 1990, what had happened was that an entire industry, entire entrepreneurial class, we had tied them down their hands, we had tied their legs, and we were telling them to perform. This was the situation in 1991. The ability, the entrepreneurial potential was kind of suppressed, and they were tied down by so many rules and regulations and procedures, and within that they were, the degrees of freedom that they had were rather limited. So the first thing what we did under liberalization was to give them scope, unleashing the entrepreneurial spirit of the private sector. That was liberalization. What did we do? I don't want to go into all the details of what we did, but essentially the message was, make them free to do what they want to do. This freedom was not there earlier. Earlier, as you know, our economy was known as a licensed Raj kind of economy, because what you will produce was decided by the government. Where you will produce was decided by the government. How much you will produce was decided by the government. What price you will sell was decided by the government. Whom you will sell was decided by the government. So government was having this overarching control of everything, under which there was the entrepreneurial spirit of this country was stifled. And this is what we changed, or tried to change, the government tried to change, by giving them freedom, giving the private sector freedom. Now we are having a particular approach. Freedom doesn't mean by switch of button you give total freedom. But for example, one stroke, MRTP was, they took the punch out of MRTP, the Monopolies and Distributed Practices Act. The licensing system was changed by one stroke. And the number of industries which were exclusively kept for public sector, that was reduced and more scope was given to others. Now this is a process. You have to understand, this change or reform is never an event, it's always a process. And we have accepted a gradualistic kind of approach. I will come to that in a moment. So liberalization was basically decontrolling, making the private sector find its own spirit and potential by giving them freedom and scope. This was liberalization, and it was done through various means. The second one was privatization. Privatization is a bad word in India. The moment you talk about, there are people, you talk about privatization, some people have high BP, some people have low BP, some people have both at the same time. I don't know how they manage that, but they do. Because privatization, there's so much we have talked against privatization. But come to think of it, you should not take a doctrinaire kind of view. Because we still have a lot of people in this country who are basically on the left side of the ideological balance. You scratch on the surface and their leftist leanings will come out. Whole world has given that up. Whole world has given that up. But you will find people, and a large majority is in Pune, I can tell you that. No, it is true. More than Bombay, you will have Pune, the people with the left orientation, or at least they claim. It is an hypocrisy because they themselves don't believe it anymore. But they have been doing it for all these years. They have to keep doing it. Now, what had happened was, when the country became independent, it was natural for the government to take lead in the industry. But what happened was, in that enthusiasm, government got into every walk of life where they did not have gone. Now, what business government had to go into tourism sector? What business government had to go into production of bread? I mean, it doesn't require big technology. Private sector could have easily done that. But the way we evolved, what happened was, the private sector was not developed, or so was the excuse used. So government steps in, and government went into every production sector. And over a period of time, do you know how much investment government has made into this public sector entity? Both at the central government level and state government level. Over a period of time, about 300,000 crores of rupees were poured into public sector. The central government as well as the state government, PSUs. And what is the rate of return that government has been getting? By the way, when I say government poured it, what is government? It's you and me, people's money. So 300,000 crores of rupees went into PSU, and the rate of return has been 2.5 to 3%. So the question that you must ask yourself, should we keep doing that? Would you borrow from market at 12% and put where the rate of return is 2.5 and 3%? And why? So you start questioning. Would you do it for your family? No, you wouldn't. Then why would you do it for your country? And why would you want that to continue? This is what privatization is all about. Privatization means that the sectors where government had gone into will be retreating and making it available for others. Privatization, I never take a doctrinaire position on privatization. My rule of thumb is very simple. If privatization is going to improve the productivity, we have to support that. But if it is not going to improve productivity, I will not support it. As simple as that. Because bottom line is competitive efficiency. And this is going to be the bottom line for your future. Competitive efficiency. You know, perform or perish is bound to be the kind of change that you are going to face. And we are already moving in that direction. But let me come to that point a little later. Here, what has happened is, government is, in various fields, government is coming out and giving the scope to private sector. They called it disinvestment, because the equity investment that government had made, a part of that was put out on the market. To that extent, government's managerial control was expected to be reduced and transferred to private sector. This is good. Now it is picking up momentum. We are talking about it for last 6-7 years quite seriously, but it has picked up momentum only last year because of all kinds of debates that have been taking place, because we are psychologically handicapped and we don't want privatization. That has been our mindset that is changing. People are recognizing the need. Only thing is that the accent has to be on privatization by itself does not necessarily improve productivity. And if it is not, there's no need to support privatization. Just as it was wrong to take an anti-power privatization position by the left, it would also be wrong to take a pro-privatization position on the extreme right. I think the ground rule there should be whether it is going to add to the productivity. If it is, we should be supported. If it is not, it should not be supported. That is happening now, and I expect this to get big momentum in the course of time. We have already started. The momentum is building, and Arun Shaw is doing a fantastic job. Last 1.5 years, 2 years, the process really has picked up, and it will accelerate very fast now, or so I hope. The third one, most important one, is globalization. Globalization, basically, you know, there are lots of people, again, a large majority in Pune. There are a lot of people who feel that the whole world is conspiring against you, you know? Think about it. You know, world did not have to conspire against you. You know who conspired against you? You yourselves, and in you I include myself. We as people, we have always had fears, and this happens to all countries which have become recently independent. It is natural that when you come out of 150 years of foreign rules, you will have that mindset where you are afraid of foreigners. But I think in India, it went too far, and we have always been afraid. And we feel that, you know, I have actually met people who are saying that we should not open up our business because these people come in for profit. So I said, do you know a businessman who is in business not for profit but for something else? Businessman is there for profit, so he is bound to come in for profit. He is not coming for social work. That has to be accepted as a part of reality. And what's wrong with profit? I mean, the mindset, I'm coming towards the end, I will talk about the mindset that we are had and kind of change that is taking place there. But basically what happened was, we had this fear all along, In early 70s, we had a major dilemma, major debate in our country, whether to go for export promotion or to go for import substitution. And I think we made a strategic mistake in the early 70s in going for export, rather than export promotion, we went for import substitution. The so-called Asian tigers, which are small countries, but you know, they made tremendous progress in 30 years. They had a crisis later, is a different thing. I'll talk about that too. But Asian tigers, Asian miracle, was these small countries. South Korea and Thailand and Indonesia and Malaysia and Taiwan, Singapore. But these four in the main, where they achieved a whole lot in 20, 30 years. They opted for export promotion. We opted for import substitution. Again, because of the fear that I had. And what happened? What was the net result? I think we missed the bus there in the early 70s when we opted for it. What was the end result? In 1991, you know, especially those who think that the whole world is conspiring against us, you know, just note what has happened. We are 15% of world's population as a nation. We are 7.5% of world's land. And undoubtedly, the most intelligent people in the world. And what has been our share in the world, in the world trade? Now it is 0.7, but in 1991 it was 0.5%, 0.5% of the world's trade. Those who talk about big Indian market should know that you are a very small market. You have only 0.5% of world's trade. So let's not have any pretense or any misgiving about the size of our market. 0.5%. Now, did it require anybody else conspiring? No. This was your own policy choice that led you to be virtually marginalized. That had to change, and we had to come to the mainstream. A lot of people are surprised when I say that we are the most intelligent people in the world. I can assure you, you know, I have gone all over, as Chaini Sahab has mentioned. I have never seen anywhere people as intelligent as Indians. And I'm not saying it because I'm talking to Indians. I have said that elsewhere too. It's unbelievable. You know, when I was teaching in America, just a brief diversion, I was teaching mathematics. And there was this undergrad student. And I was teaching her logarithm. She had some question about logarithm. And I told her, if you take a logarithm of a number, and then you take anti-logarithm, you get back the original number. She looked at me and said, Mosh, you are a genius. any seventh grade, eighth grade boy or girl in India is genius by that standard. So what I mean is, we are so talented. Then why is it that we have not delivered as far as the international economy is concerned? It's because of our own making. Nobody has made any conspiracy against you. You did it yourself, we did it ourselves, and we are finally coming out. Now, this is the process of globalization. Globalization essentially means integrating your economy with the world economy. That is the meaning of globalization. In the last 10 years, what has happened is that all those economies, why last 10 years, last 25 years of globalization, countries which had remained out of the mainstream of the world are desperately trying to join. Desperately. And two examples which come to my mind. Take all those economies like Soviet Union and the East European countries which were part of the Soviet power bloc earlier. They all want to be the mainstream now. They all. They are desperately trying to be mainstream. China, which was always outside the mainstream, last few years it has desperately tried to come in. 1978 they started the reform and they have been making an application to become a part of WTO for 16 years. 16 attempts were made by China to join WTO. And there are people here who are saying that yesterday, day before yesterday, Mera Partner said, we should come out of WTO. It's a very irresponsible kind of statement. We can't. We were the founder members of WTO. And when the whole world is trying to join them, why should we just quit? And suppose that we quit, what do we achieve? If there is a problem with USA or any other country, what is the forum that we have to redress our problems? No forum, because you have left it. This is an anarchist kind of argument. I'm not saying that WTO are all very nice people. Of course, they're doing the best for their country. Nobody is stopping you from doing best for your country. You be the part of the forum, especially when you are a founder member. Fight it out. and get the best possible deal. Leaving it and coming out, which Sulabhara Main Pune is saying or Meda Patkar saying there, is absolutely irresponsible, and that you should understand. That you have to be within the system and fight within the system. Going out is not going to be helpful to anyone. What advantage will have? But we have this. We have this. And that has to change. And it is changing. Take the case of, there are only two countries in my opinion, only two countries in the world who have not joined the mainstream. One is Myanmar, Burma, and the other is, which is the other country? See, I have forgotten the name of that country too. It's so such a, this is the important thing. It's an important point. You don't even remember that country, North Korea. These are the two countries which are the only two countries today who have not joined the mainstream. And we have all forgotten them. Nobody. You know, we have this feeling, while we have remained away from the world, we have also had this feeling that we don't need the world, you see. The world needs us. Nonsense. You need the world as much as the world needs you. There cannot be a one-way traffic there. You need the world and the world needs you. But if you choose to stay away from the world, nobody is going to shed any tears for that. Only you will be left with the tears for yourself in future. So the point is that we have to integrate ourselves into the world economy, and we are doing that. What are we doing? In every walk of life, you will see that we have reduced our import duties. We have, following the WTO regulations and their prescriptions, we have opened up for foreign direct investment. We have opened up for foreign direct investment, portfolio investment, and these are the different channels through which Indian economy is getting integrated with the rest of the world. And that is changing the whole thing. So that national boundaries that we talk about are breaking. They will remain political boundaries. But in terms of economic thing, the world is coming together, and we are now trying to integrate. Now, in all these changes, please understand that our approach is gradualism. The choices, the two extremes there are, one extreme is gradualism, and the second approach is Big Bang. We temperamentally are for gradualistic approach. So we are not nimble-footed like tigers or Asian tigers. But we like to believe that we are more like elephants, which move slowly, but they are sure-footed. There are many countries which have reformed in haste and have gone back on reforms. We have never done that. We have never done that. So we may be slow in moving, and certainly the pace has to accelerate in future, but we are moving in a sure-footed manner. The direction is very clear, and this direction is going to change completely. It is changing. It has been changing, and it will change what you have out there in future. What you need for that is the proper mindset. Now this, the old convictions about the old mindset that we have had about the fear about the foreigner, or being the closed economy, fear about the private sector, all those things are gone, going. There are some places stubbornly they still are there, but you have to eschew all this kind of attitude and look at the world in terms of an opportunity and be ready to face the challenges. Most important thing there is that you have to have a change of mindset, your attitude. Attitude is absolutely the most important thing in your success, your mindset and your attitude. Let me give you two examples of how wrong attitude or wrong mindset can change your life or refuses to change your life. One is the old example, you know, many years back when President Kennedy was president there and Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru was the Prime Minister in India, a lot of people used to come to India and they used to, mutual exchange was there. And there was this group of American Peace Corps, young people like you, they were in India and they were taking a walk. You know, they wanted to understand the rural country. And they were going through, and they saw, it was 10 o'clock in the morning, and a big banyan tree, and a lot of our compatriots, whom in Bombay they call Bhaiyal, they are sitting there and gudgudi here. These people were surprised, 10 o'clock in the morning, and you know, these people are sitting under this banyan tree and merrily going gudgudi. So they went and close to them. Some of them could speak Hindi. They said, aaj aap koi tyohar ka din hai? Nahi, nahi, hamara tyohar nahi. आखिर आज छुट्टी का दिन होगा? नहीं, वो छुट्टी का दिन भी नहीं, फिर त्योहार भी नहीं, छुट्टी का दिन भी नहीं, फिर आप बैठे? हाँ बैठे। तो आप काम क्यों नहीं करते? अरे साहब, काम करने से क्या होगा? काम करने से क्या हो? काम करने से आपको पैसा मिलेगा. अमेरिकन्स आर वेरी प्रॉम्प्ट ऑन दैट. अरे पैसा मिलने से क्या होगा साहब. अमेरिकन कांट आंसर दैट क्वेश्चन. फॉर देम गेटिंग मनी इज फॉर गेटिंग मनी. पैसा मिलने से क्या होगा. पैसा मिलने से आप आराम कर सकते हैं. अरे वो तो हम अभी भी कर रहे हैं. Are going to take a bypass. You are on bypass. They will take a bypass and go away. And you will remain where you are. Therefore, I think the most important thing is to change the mindset and embrace the world. There is another example that I want to give, a favorite of my jokes which I tell to the students. You know, there is this guy. He goes home and he is very excited. And he's very excited. His wife says, "क्यों क्या हो गया? अरे आज हमने तो कमाल कर दिया. आज हमने पूरा कमाल कर दिया. अरे क्या कमाल कर दिया आपने? आज हमने रेलवे को उल्लू बना दिया. रेलवे को उल्लू बना दिया? वो कैसे? अरे हमने ट्रेन टिकट निकाला था लेकिन हम गए. Those who do not think or those who think that they are doing themselves a favor by not joining globalization are exactly like these people. They think that they have cheated the world or they have cheated the railways by not taking the journey. The railway has not lost anything. The loss is entirely of this man. If you don't join the mainstream, if you don't go for globalization, the illusion, the pleasure, the happiness that you will have would be an illusion like that. And I think quite the target. Now these are some of the changes taking place. What is going to be the basic, you know, basic focus in future as you go out? I think the most important thing is going to be competitive efficiency. Competitive efficiency will be bottom line of whatever you do, whether you have your industry, where you have your job, whichever walk of life you are, competitive efficiency is the first thing that you will have to do. And because, you know, the kind of feeling that the way we have grown, apna aadmi hai, that kind of stuff is not going to be relevant as you go along. You have to prove, and you have not only have to be good, you have to prove that you are good all the time. And that is going to be the bottom line. In America, they talk about, for example, for teachers, they talk about publish or perish. And I think this is very, very important. There, if you are a professor, and if you don't keep reading and writing articles, research papers, you will lose your job. That kind of thing is permeating here too. Not only in education. I would like to generalize and say that you perform or perish. Nobody, I assure you, even today, nobody is going to be interested in knowing the soft story that you may have about why you could not do it. Nobody has time. Nobody has inclination. Whether you have done it or you have not done it. Nobody has time to listen to your story, why you could not do it. Who has the time? So, bottom line is you have to stand up and deliver. And if you don't deliver, you'll be judged on the basis of your ability to deliver. If you don't, you will face the music. This is going to be the change. Now, with this change, what has happened is that this globalization business, it's not all positive. There are lots of side effects from this, which are, you know, which thinkers, broader thinkers will have to think. But one thing that has happened is that our family, the people are becoming more and more individualist. See, once upon a time, again, Pune is the, you know, the cultural center, and there are enough scholars who will tell you that in Maharashtra, family at one point of time was defined as if somebody has a kanta in your feet, all those people who get tears in their eyes is your family. This is the concept. You know, if you have a thorn, and everybody who gets tears in his eyes is your family. That has changed. We are a joint family. Then we are a smaller family. Now we have many families. And within the family, we see people are becoming more and more individualistic. Now, whether this is good, bad, ugly, we don't know. Others will think about it. But you have to accept that as a change. And that is something which you will have to imbibe in yourself, that while I go for a relentless pursuit of my goals, my achievements, I will try to keep my attitude as broad and socially oriented as possible. Because while you can't change the environment individually or so you think, collectively you always do. And therefore, rather than taking it for granted, you must
have a social kind of dimension to whatever you do. And that will give you a more gratifying kind of contribution that you will make. Some of these changes we have talked about, some more we will talk. I have crossed my 45 minutes just now. I think I'll stop my monologue here, and from here onwards until 12 o'clock, we'll talk, we'll discuss things in response to the questions that you might have. So questions, feel free to ask questions. I don't have answers to all questions, but I will do my best. I thought we'll give priority to students.
Okay.
I'll give the questions of faculty.
All the tough questions they
ask. Okay, fine.
Students. I can see a googly coming in here. We have been waiting for a googly. Yeah.
You guessed it right.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for such a wonderful speech. So in spite of all the trade promotional activities like EOUs or EPZs or special economic zones, we are lagging behind, as you rightly pointed out, with only 0.6% of the share of international trade. So what prevents us to make a free trade zones like Singapore or perhaps Hong Kong has, so that we can boost up our trade?
Good question. No, there's nothing preventing us. If we have not done it, it's because we have not been able to do it. But we do have free trade zones in a smaller manner. We have export promoting EPZs, you know, export promoting zones. Even in Bombay we have SIBs and elsewhere. So we have made a beginning in small way, but we haven't had an opportunity to do it in a big way. At one point in July 2002, Dr. Jalan, our governor of Reserve Bank, made an announcement. There was a conference in Bombay where he made an announcement that the entire northeastern zone, northeastern region, could be converted into a free trade zone. And in fact, I've been working on that idea. It's very complicated because that is an area where there are lots of foreign influence. China is the border, there are too many borders there, and there is a lot of off-border trade which already goes on. So it's not going to be confinable. We want to do that, but we have not been able to do it as much as we can. But it is not true that Indian exports are not doing well. Indian exports are doing extremely well. Look at 2002-2003, last 1 year. Let me explain to you the global situation. You can sit down. Look at the global situation and see how we have done. We have done remarkably well, remarkably well. Let me spend 5 minutes talking about it. This is an important point I'm going to make. One is that, look at the world situation. If you look at the situation in the world economy, world typically, in the last 50 years or so, you know what happens in the world is, there are three power blocks. USA, then there is Euroland, the European Community country, and then there is Japan. Traditionally, these are the three countries, or three power blocks, which maintain the momentum of world trade. All along, it has always been. If two of them are down, the third one comes up. At any point of time, at least one of them is pushing the whole world economic growth to a higher plane. They keep the momentum. After a very long, now look at the three, what is happening? Japan has always been in trouble for last 10 years. Japan is in big trouble for last 10 years. So Japan doesn't count in terms of giving impetus to the world economy. So the choice is between USA and Euroland. USA had the longest and the strongest expansion in the recorded history. That came to an end in 2001. From 1993 to 2001, the longest expansion in the recorded history in USA. 2001, they stopped that. I mean, they slowed down. The expansion, the acceleration stopped or slowed down. Now it was expected, Japan going down for a long time, America slowing down, it was expected that Europe will pick up and give the leadership to the world economy. It did not happen. So we have had for last 1.5 to 2 years, first time in world history, we have a situation where there's a phenomenon we talk about called synchronized global slowdown. All three going down together. It has never happened. It has never happened. And which are the countries? Which are the countries which have given some boost to the world economic growth? China and India. If you subtract the contribution that India and China's growth rate have made to the world economic growth would have been in recession. But for China and India. China, of course, in much bigger way than India. But you have to notice that one of the nice effects, good effects of the last 10 years of reform was that India had now emerged as one of the fastest growing economies in the world. Not in the region, in the world. Now there, let me explain this a little bit. This is very important. And we have just now the annual report that 3 days back we released makes this point. And you must read that and note this point. What had happened is, in India, if you take a view, long-term view, first 30 years, whichever way you take the growth rate average in India, it would come to 3.5%. 3.5% was not bad, but not much either. Because if your population is growing at the rate of 2.2% and if your real GDP grows at the rate of 3.5%, you will improve the per capita income.